Rohingya Muslim refugees living in Bangladesh struggle to survive even in the best circumstances. But now heavy monsoon rains are making their lives even more unbearable. Over the past few days, thousands of people have been displaced within the refugee camps in a coastal city because of floods and landslides. UNICEF says two young boys have drowned in the floods, and there's more rain in the forecast as monsoon season stretches on. Here's Ivan Watson with more about it.
The monsoon season has arrived in Bangladesh, and it's causing chaos for people already living in crisis. The rains flooded overcrowded refugee camps in Cox's Bazar, which are home to around a million Rohingya Muslims, most of whom fled nearby Myanmar during a military crackdown, which the UN says could amount to genocide, claims Myanmar denies. Hundreds of makeshift shelters collapsed in muddy landslides. Thousands of families relocated to temporary shelters. Hafizullah and his family were sent to a nearby school since their house was a flood risk. But in the process, they lost nearly everything.
We were staying at another place when the rains came, and in that time, our things were stolen. I have lost everything of mine. That's why I have to live in the dark now. I lost my light and battery.
The couple's children were already malnourished before the rains hit. Now the floods have made their difficult young lives even harder.
We can't cook anything because I think my stove is damaged. We don't have food to eat now, so we can't give anything to our children. They can't drink the water, and they can't go outside because of the floods.
My children are suffering from fever, but we don't have any medicine. We are living in real hardship here.
Even before the floods, the situation in the camps was dire, a daily struggle to collect much-needed aid, now complicated after some main pathways collapsed.
It is very difficult because the paths become very muddy. People have a lot of trouble sometimes to reach the service points, so for children to go to school, because there is not the sufficient infrastructure in the camps and because of the crowdedness.
Aid agencies say they're scrambling to help people in the camps, and they're trying to prevent the spread of waterborne diseases. The Bangladesh Foreign Ministry told CNN that it is well prepared along with the UN system to face any eventualities in terms of the Rohingya refugee camps. The priority for Hafizullah: fix his makeshift shelter so that the family can come back home. His neighbors are doing the same. But basic building materials provide flimsy protection from more heavy rain. There's another deluge forecast this week, and months of monsoon season still ahead. The lives of those who had so little to begin with, now even more precarious.
We're just living with crisis. We lost everything. But so what? At least we are alive now.
Ivan Watson, CNN.
Photographer Thomas Naibo has spent about 6 months in these camps over the past year on assignment for UNICEF, and he just returned from Bangladesh on Wednesday and joins me now. Thomas, good to see you.
Thank you.
Seeing the resilience of these people, seeing the smiles on children's faces, that's the hopeful part there, but you've worked in more than 100 places in this world and seen some really bad things. Where do you put this?
I put it at the top for many reasons. I arrived 3 weeks ago in the camp, and at first, it appeared like things were under control. They'd actually built drainage systems. They'd prepared as best they could for the monsoon season. But then by 3-4 days of rain, everything had changed. Mike Tyson said, everyone's got a plan until you get punched in the face. And the Rohingya just got punched in the face. So when you have flooding, not only do you have these flimsy houses that are flooding, but you have fresh water sources are flooding. Toilets are flooding. So all of a sudden, even you have a boy, you know, crossing a stream, he might get sick. So
right.
it affects everything.
I can imagine. Let's look through your photos right now. I think this first one is extremely powerful. It's a woman and what happened to her and her baby is just unconscionable.
Aisha is now 20. Aisha's not her real name. So a year and a half ago, she was coming across with her three children and her husband. Soldiers grabbed her 7-year-old son, threw him in the air, killed him viciously with a machete. Then they beat her and gang raped her. If you look closely, you can see a scar from a rifle butt on her forehead. When I met her, it was 2 months after the attacks. Her eyes were red from burst blood vessels. Her eyes were black underneath. And this was months later. She was very angry. I caught up with her and spent a lot of time with her over the past couple weeks. And there was joy in her life. She'd been attending a UNICEF counseling session and able to connect with other girls. And she said she was trying to forget what happened to her, but she still wants justice. And she was also terribly afraid because they live on the side of a hill, like so many Rohingya, and water was seeping in on the floor, and she was afraid.
Well, again, you know, it's just you hope for these people so much, but they are enduring so much. Now we have a photograph you took of a father, a teenage father, whose home is collapsing in that mud there.
19-year-old Abdul, he lives there with his two children, his elderly father and his wife, and the entire hill collapsed into his house, filling it with mud. And he's been working nonstop trying to shovel it out. And I asked him, you know, what do you need? And he said, you know what I need? I need a wall, a proper wall, mm-hmm. because I don't even have the money to buy the plastic to fix this. So what am I supposed to tell my children? How am I going to be safe?
Right. Next, a boy is crossing the river, swollen from days of monsoon rains, and then he actually goes into the river, and he is swimming. Why is he in there?
Everybody was telling me the same thing. We don't have cash. They get rice, they get dal to eat, but if you want vegetables, if you want fish, you need to get money by any means necessary. For a lot of kids, like this boy with the umbrella, it's collecting plastic to sell to the recyclers. So when floods hit the hills, they fill the streams and rivers with plastics. Even though the boys, the children, don't know how to swim, they'll go out there as best they can just to get plastics to sell to help feed their families.
Right, that shows you how the children, it's all in for survival here. And our next picture mirrors that as well. A girl taking care of her father, he's behind her in this photograph. His leg was shot off by a soldier in Myanmar.
That's true, and his other leg, his good leg, is now atrophied, and so he's stuck in their house, and they live on the edge of a dirt cliff, and he has a wheelchair, but it takes four men putting him in a bamboo sling just to get him out to a proper way, hundreds of meters away. So she goes to a UNICEF-supported school when she can, but a lot of the time, she's the only one who can look after her father, and so she's the stereotypical story of a caregiver who might actually die before her father because she's constantly stressed out and worrying herself sick.
And one mother said, we can't cook anything because the stove is damaged. We don't have food to eat now. We can't give anything to our children, and they can't drink the water or go outside because of the floods. Everyone has suffered in this crisis, Thomas, children to the elderly, and 60,000 children now cannot get educated. And you have a picture, though, of one boy determined to learn English on his own.
I love the story. I was walking through the camp through heavy mud, and I heard this boy reading basic English, a story about a picnic at the park. And I was drawn to it, and I tracked him down, and he was teaching himself English, also going to a local English tutor, and all he wanted to do was learn English. He was too old, 18, for some of the schools, so he was teaching himself. My colleagues and I, some of us, we got together three new books for him. We got him a book called Hunger, a Classic, The Alchemist, and then a more advanced English textbook. And when I handed him these books, it was like I gave him the keys to a helicopter. Mm-hmm. I mean, he literally left and went and put on his best shirt and posed for a picture with the books.
Oh, my goodness. The Alchemist, that's a good one. That was a good choice, I think. And the first story he was reading was called A Picnic in the Park. You know, and look what they're dealing with. How much more suffering, though, do you think these people can take? You know, we know UNICEF is pleading for more funding, but it's not there.
My hat's off to Bangladesh for housing over 900,000 Rohingya. The challenge is there's a lot of talk about what's next for them. There's talk about repatriation to Myanmar, but the question really needs to be presented to the Rohingya. I think before any decisions are made, because everyone's coming to the conclusion this is where they belong. Well, how do the Rohingya feel about that? When I talk to the Rohingya, they want justice, they want protection, they want citizenship. And I think until those things are given, nobody can make plans for where they're going to live their lives. It's a basic right, and they deserve at least that much.
And meantime, they are stuck. And now they're stuck in this horrible situation. Yes, the Prime Minister of Bangladesh said the huge number of Rohingyas is destabilizing. She wants them, of course, to go back to Myanmar because of the other issue, which is deforestation, which they're trying to carve out homes. You know,
it's an impossible situation. And as was mentioned in the package, there are 4 months left in the monsoon season, and everything is affected. The schools, the water, the latrines, the houses. How can anyone have any sleep worrying about their children? You have to remember, too, you might have as many as 8 or 9 people living in one of these flimsy plastic tents, and as water's coming in, is the hill going to collapse? Are my children going to be safe? So it's a day-to-day struggle, but they still want justice.
And they deserve it so much. Well, your pictures help tell the story. As tough as it is, it's important for the world to see. So important. Thomas Naibo, thank you so much.
Thank you, Natalie.
Thanks for coming in.